let us, I will just go again velocity profile. So, what is there is, this is steady flow in pipes. So, what we said, this is the Hagen-Poiseuille flow. What we said is that velocity, now if it is a fully developed flow, what will be there? Vz is going to be a function of only R. Vz is going to be a function of R, and there will be no Vr and V theta. That is what is fully developed concept. So, using that fully developed concept, we neglected Vr momentum, R momentum equation and theta momentum equation. If we neglect that, those two equations, that is, you see, I have written here Vr equal to V theta equal to 0, because it is fully developed flow, and Vz is only a function of R, not theta and z. Please note this. Now, R momentum equation and theta momentum equation is not at all required, because Vr and V theta is just not there. And now, I have to take Vz equation. Now, you see here, first term on the left hand side is 0, because Vr is 0. Second term on the left hand side equation is 0, because V theta is 0, and Vz is not a function of z, but it is a function of R. So, del Vz by del z also becomes 0. So, whole of left hand side is 0. Now, what is on the right hand side? 0 equal to minus 1 by rho del p by del z plus nu into del squared Vz by del r squared plus 1 by r del Vz by del r. Vz is not a function of theta, and Vz is not a function of z. That is why these two terms get become 0. Now, if I substitute this, if I take this equation and do the algebra, this is algebra which I do not intend to do. Only thing I want to emphasize is that there are two boundary conditions. When r equal to r, that means I am just at the pipe wall, Vz is equal to 0, which is no slip condition. And when r equal to 0, dvz by dr equal to 0. This is, the velocity profile is symmetric. So, taking these two boundary conditions, I get a and b's, which are constant, and I get this paraboloid velocity profile, and which, from which we can show that Vz average is equal to half times the Vz maximum velocity, that is the center line velocity. And shear stress can be calculated taking mu dvz by dr, because I have got the velocity profile. This is what we keep saying, to get the shear stress, I need to know the velocity profile. Only if I know the velocity profile, I can do this differentiation. So, that is what we are saying, and we get the friction factor. Okay. So, with this, we will move on to the heat transfer. I will come to all of this fluid mechanics little later. Okay. After I derive this, I will take you through that detour of fluid mechanics on a fast track again. Please be prepared for fast track. But for now, I am going to go as slow as I can for temperature profile and Nusselt number. What is that I am doing? I am taking a circular pipe. I am taking, let me define my problem. My problem is, it is a circular pipe. Okay. It is a circular pipe, flow is in this direction, and we consider steady and incompressible flow and laminar. What are we trying to look at? To get the temperature distribution as a function of R, and I will try to get the temperature, and from that I will get the Nusselt number distribution, that is the heat transfer coefficient. Let us see how do we do that. We will first have to take the energy equation, that is rho Cp del T plus Vr. See, yesterday's derivation, whatever we derived, is it that is for Cartesian coordinates? We can do the same derivation for cylindrical and spherical coordinates. So, if we do for cylindrical coordinates, I get V r del t by del r plus V theta by r del t by del theta plus V into del t by del x is equal to k 1 by r del t by del r plus 1 by r square del square t by del theta square plus del square t by del x squared plus q dot plus phi v. There is no volumetric heat generation. So, that is why I am making q dot equal to 0. One of the participants were asking yesterday, q dot should be there. You can see q dot being there in the energy equation. And viscous dissipation is not there because I have assumed that the flow is incompressible. If I do that, now I will take another, I need to take another assumption, that is my flow is fully developed. In what sense? Both in hydrodynamic sense and also in thermal sense. It is thermally and hydrodynamically it is fully developed. So, if I take that, what do I get? If I take that, we have the velocity profile already. You see, I have not mentioned this is V z earlier what I was using. Instead of writing all the time V z, I am just writing it as V. Okay? So, I have rho C p V del t by del x, that is stream wise direction, and these two I am taking steady flow. So, del t by del t is cancelled out. Fully developed means V r equal to 0, V theta equal to 0, these two terms go out as 0. So, I am left out on the left hand side, rho C p V del t by del x. What about on the right hand side? Temperature is not a function of theta and it is not a function of x, that is what we have seen. We have seen that these two are not there. So, what is that I am having? 1 by r del by del r del t by del r. So, if I take these two terms, rho C p V del t by del x equal to k 1 upon r del by del r del t by del r, I get V del t by del x equal to k by rho C p is alpha by r del by del r del t by del r. Now, what is to be figured out here? Now, we are doing another boundary condition. What is the boundary condition I am solving it for? I am solving it for constant heat flux. I am not solving this for constant wall temperature. I am solving this for constant heat flux. And Professor Arun has already shown us that for constant heat flux boundary condition, what is dT by dx? He has shown that dT by dx equal to 2 q dot upon rho C p V m r, V m is the average velocity, q dot s is the constant heat flux. This has been coming from simple energy balances and applying energy, simple energy balances and Newton's law of cooling. I am applying that and I am getting this. Okay? That is what I am going to invoke or use that. That means, basically what I mean to say is, I know dT by dx in terms of constant heat flux and the mass flow rate. Let us see how do we put that. So, if I put that is dT by del t by del x equal to del T s by del x equal to del T m by del x equal to q 2 q dot s upon rho C p V m into r. This is constant. That is what we have seen. That is the slope of the bulk mean temperature and slope of the constant, slope of the wall temperature, both are same. That is what we said. This is the basic check what we do while doing experiments. If I plot temperature versus x, if it is fully developed, my T s is going to be linear, so is my bulk temperature, and the difference between the two at any location is going to be constant. This is the first basic check what we do when we do experiments. If that is not coming, then something is wrong, because I can check always T s. While I am doing experiments, I cannot measure bulk mean temperature at every location, can I? No, professor showed us that it has to be integrated at every location, velocity and temperature. At every location I need velocity and temperature. This data is not easy to come by, and that too especially I should be doing this non-intrusively. If I put a thermocouple or put a hot wire anemometer, it is going to intrude and disturb my velocity profile and the temperature profile. What do I do? I usually measure the bulk temperature at the inlet, and what do? I measure the bulk temperature at the exit. How do I measure this? How do I measure this? If it is water, it is much easy. If it is water, all that I need to do is, in fact, it is also called as mixing cup temperature. Why? Because this is taken through a pipe where it gets mixed up. that is there is a mixing cup, that is let me draw that, let us say this is a pipe and now it is made to go through a mixing cup, wherein which it is asked to go through lot of tortuous paths and then collect that in a flask and put a thermocouple or a thermometer in this flask and get the temperature. Whatever temperature you get by mixing this in the mixing cup and then taking it to a flask and measuring is what is called as the mixing cup temperature or the bulk mean temperature. This you can do only at the exit, you cannot do anywhere at the center, anywhere in between. So, you get usually the bulk mean temperature at the exit and the bulk mean temperature at the So, bulk mean temperature at the inlet. So, I am just taking one question from JNTU Hyderabad.
A condition wherein both constant wall temperature and constant heat flux can be maintained simultaneously. If it is not possible, why is it not possible? Over to you, sir.
Okay. See, the question is, can I maintain constant heat flux and constant wall temperature simultaneously? I will not answer this question through heat transfer. I will answer this question through electricity. I will pose back, professor, this question to you like this. Can I maintain constant voltage and constant current in any transformer or any DC power supply simultaneously both?
It is not possible, sir.
So, now similarly, it is not possible to maintain constant heat flux and constant wall temperature. We understand electricity very well. So, that is the reason I took this analogy. So, no offense in this. The point is, it is very difficult. We cannot maintain the same potential difference and as have the same constant heat flux also, the same current also. It is just not possible. One of the two can be maintained. Similarly, if I maintain constant heat flux, potentials get fixed, that is the temperatures. If I maintain constant constant temperature, currents get fixed, that is the heat fluxes. So, we cannot maintain both of them together, professor. Any other question, professor?
Just a minute.
Sir, the question is regarding the skin friction coefficient and friction factor, sir. What is the difference between the two and what is the physical significance of Darcy's friction factor?
The question asked is, what is Darcy's friction factor and how is it related to skin friction factor and what is the physical significance of Darcy's friction factor? Okay, I do not see this any of my transparencies, but I think I need to derive this, let me do that. So, what do we do for Darcy's friction factor? So, we derive skin friction factor or we define CF equal to tau all upon half rho u mean squared. I am doing this for circular pipe because that makes it easy. Okay. Now, what is friction factor defined for a circular pipe? If I take a pipe and there is a flow taking place, how do I define this? HF equal to, what is that? HF equal to F L V squared divided by 2 G D. Let me multiply on both sides rho G. What do I get? Delta P equal to rho F L V squared divided by 2 D. How did this come from actually? Actually, it came like this. Delta P divided by rho V squared is, when I do the non-dimensional analysis, which was done by Buckingham's pi theorem. In fact, there no Navier-Stokes equation was done. Nikuradze perhaps did this using Buckingham's pi theorem because he is the one who has reported the friction factor data which we use in the form of the Moody's chart. That is delta P upon half rho V squared is directly proportional, is a function of L by D and friction factor. If I combine this, this is what it is, delta P equal to rho F L V squared divided by 2 D. Now, this is, what is this? This is Darcy's friction factor. Now, how do I connect this friction factor with skin friction factor? Now, let us do that. If I take a small control volume in the pipe, okay, and this is my pressure P 1 and this is my pressure here P 2, and what is the shear stress? Tau wall, which is acting opposite to the flow direction. So, what do I get? Tau wall into, tau wall is acting like heat transfer coefficient, it is like bathing area, that is inside surface area, that is pi into d into L. This should be equated by pressure force, that is delta P. I am not writing delta P equal to P 1 minus P 2, we very well know that. Delta P into pi d squared by 4. So, pi pi gets cancelled, d d gets cancelled. So, I am getting with tau wall equal to delta P into d by L upon 4. Okay. Now, let me substitute this tau wall. Now, what is this tau wall? Okay. Now, if I substitute this tau wall in this equation, or I can substitute in this equation, if I substitute this, what do I get? Delta P equal to tau wall into L by D into 4. Is that right? Delta P equal to. Now, if you equate, I am not going to do that. If you put this here in this equation and in turn compare with that equation, you are going to get 4 equal F equal to 4 C F. So, what is that? What is that essentially we are saying? Friction F is also shear stress, tau C F is also shear stress. It is just that the way we have defined C F and the way we have defined F is different, that is all. That is all that is. That is F equal to, what did we write? F equal to delta P, that is F equal to delta P divided by rho V squared by 2 into L by D. That is pressure drop increases with the increase of the length, that is L by D. That is very obvious to see. That is what Nikuraj said, did using Buckingham's pi theorem. But people had defined CF as tau wall upon half rho U m squared. Usually CF definition is usually used for external flows. Rarely we use for internal flows, but not to say that we never use it, we do use, but rarely we use. So, this is the physical significance between F and CF. Sum and substance is that F is also shear stress, CF is also shear stress. Basically, it is the resistance offered by the flow, by the plate or the surface for the flow to take place by virtue of viscosity, that is no slip condition. That is the answer for your question, ma'am. Is that okay, ma'am?
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. One question from Jaipur College.
One Hello. Question from Jaipur College. Yes, sir. Good afternoon, sir. My question is, in thermally developing region, convective heat transfer coefficient is more or less than fully developed temperature profile?
How does the heat transfer coefficient compare in the developing and the fully developed region? If this is heat transfer coefficient and this is my streamwise direction, let us say this is my developing region and this is, let us say, fully developed region. Fully developed region. The heat transfer coefficient in the developing region continually decreases and in the fully developed region it becomes constant. Okay. So, that is the answer for your question.
My second question is, why temperature boundary layer grows much more rapidly than velocity boundary layer?
Yeah. The question asked is, why is the developing length for hydrodynamically developing length is larger than thermally developing length? Yeah, it depends on the Prandtl number, you cannot generalize like that. Let me tell the answer like this. If it is, yeah, here you see, this is Prandtl number greater than 1, delta is greater than delta t. That means what? This is delta and this is delta t. This is delta and this is delta t. So, what is this saying? For Prandtl numbers greater than 1, developing length required for thermally developing length is much smaller than hydrodynamically developing length is much smaller than the thermally developing length. So, it and for Prandtl number less than 1, opposite. That is, hydrodynamic developing length will be much larger than thermally developing length. So, why do you say that the thermal developing length is always smaller than hydrodynamically developing length? It is not true, it is not true. Okay, I think we will stop question answers, and now it is time that we will go ahead with our discussions. Okay, so we will get started with where we left. So, we said that we have steady flow, incompressible flow, and fully developed thermally and hydrodynamically, and also constant heat flux boundary condition is taken, and it is a circular pipe flow. And we showed that this is what the equation turns down to, and dT by dx is given by Q2 Q dot upon rho Vm Cp r. This is known constant heat flux. I know the average velocity, I know the radius of the pipe, I know Cp, that means dT by dx I know. Why should I know that? Because I want to substitute here for del T by del x. So, that is known now. Now, do I know V? Yes, I know the velocity profile. I have derived that in terms of center line velocity or in terms of average velocity. So, V equal to V maximum into 1 minus r by r whole square. So, if I have to present this V maximum in terms of average velocity, it would be becoming 2 into average velocity. Now, if I substitute these two here in this equation, what do I get? V equal to V maximum into 1 minus r by r whole squared. That is what I am doing in the next step. So, that is, let me do this as slow as I can. Okay. I do not want to rush through here. I have taken V del T by del x equal to alpha by r del by del r del T by del r. Please watch my words. I am going as slow as I can. V equal to V maximum into 1 minus r by r whole squared, and del T by del x equal to 2 q dot s upon rho Cp Vm r. Then what is that I am looking for? Temperature as a function of r I am looking for. If I substitute this here, and V max I am substituting for 2 into V average, because this V average can be cancelled out with this V average, into 1 minus r by r whole squared equal to alpha, I am writing this as k by rho Cp r into d by dr dt by dr. Now, you see I am saying that temperature is only a function of r. Now, rho Cp gets cancelled out, V average gets cancelled out. I get 2 into 2, 4 q dot s upon k r, that means this k I have shifted to the left hand side, k r into 1 minus r by r whole squared equal to 1 by r d by dr of r dt by dr. Now, I am going to multiply this r to the left hand side, that is, I am pushing this r which is there in the denominator of the right hand side to the left hand side. If I do that, I will have to multiply by r, that is 4 q dot s upon k r equal to r minus r cube by r square equal to d by dr of r dt by dr. That is, if I integrate this now, C 1 plus 4 q dot s upon k r into r squared by 2 minus r to the power of 4 upon 4 r squared equal to r d t by d r. Now, what is the boundary condition? Let us try to find C 1. R equal to 0, temperature profile is symmetric. So, d t by d r equal to 0. So, I get, if I substitute r equal to 0 and d t by d r equal to 0, I get C 1 equal to 0. So, now, so, I can remove this C 1 and write this equation again, and now divide it by r. So, 4 q dot s upon k r, if I divide it by r, I get r by 2 minus r cube by 4 r squared equal to d t by d r. Again I integrate this, I get C 2 plus 4 q dot s upon k r into r squared by 4 minus r to the power of 4 upon 16 r squared equal to t. Now, the onus is, or the responsibility is, to get this C 2. I take r equal to T at r equal to r, that is at the wall, T equal to T s. Do I know this T s? No. What is my boundary condition? It is constant heat flux. I do not know T s, but still, no matter whatever is the boundary condition, that is, even if it is constant heat flux, it is going to have a temperature Ts. What is the temperature? I do not know, let it be as Ts. I will take R equal to Rs, T equal to Ts, because I need to know the potential. If I do not know the potential, it is just current, I cannot solve the problem. So, I need to know the potential. So, I am assuming the potential as T equal to Ts. So, C 2 plus 4 q dot S upon k R into R squared by 4 minus R to the power of 4 upon 16 R squared equal to Ts, which will give me C 2 equal to Ts minus of 3 q S dot R upon 4 k. If I substitute this in this equation, that is substitute C 2 in this equation, which is what I have done here, I get T equal to Ts minus 3 q S dot R upon 4 k plus 4 q S dot upon k R into R squared by 4 minus R to the power of 4 upon 16 R squared. Let me simplify this. So, T equal to T s minus q s dot R upon k into 3 by 4 minus R squared by capital R squared minus plus R to the power of 4 upon 4 R to the power of 4. Now, I am, let us keep this temperature as it is, but remember I do not know T s. I need to find T m. Why do I need to find T m? Q double dash equal to H into T s minus T m. So, if I get T m, then I will be able to get my H. Q double dash I know. Let us see how do we get this T s minus T m. To get that first, I will try to get T m. So, for getting T m, I have T here. Why did I do this? Because in T m, I need a temperature profile and also the velocity profile. So, bulk temperature, we have derived this already, bulk temperature is given by 2 upon V average R squared integral of 0 to R T of R V of R R T R. Okay. So, pi pi in the numerator and denominator has got cancelled. So, I get 2 upon V average R squared. If I substitute for T of R whole of this equation, and for V R, we substitute 2 V average into 1 minus R by R whole square. This is the paraboloid which we have derived little earlier into R d R. If I integrate this, I think I will not do that integration, it is straightforward integration. If I do this integration, I am going to get T m equal to T s into T s minus 1124 Q s dot R by k. I have put all the steps, I have not skipped even a single step. So, we have tried to incorporate all the steps, please go through those steps, you will get T m minus T s or T s minus T m equal to 11 by 24 Q s dot R by k. What is H? H equal to Q s dot upon T s minus T m. For T s minus T m, I have already found this. If I substitute this, I will get 24 by L, but I have defined Nusselt number as H d by k instead of H r by k. So, I multiply by 2 both sides, I get 48 by 11. That is Nusselt number on the basis of diameter of the pipe, I get 4.3636. Now, very interesting result here. We need to stop and think. Nusselt number in laminar flow, in internal flows is constant, It is independent of both Reynolds number and Prandtl number. So, how do you explain this? I am sure you will be asking me questions. So, before you ask, I am going to preempt you. The only plausible, not possible, plausible, that is probable answer for this is that because the flow is taking place in pipe as laminae, one lamina is not acting with the another lamina. So, there is no increase of the Nusselt number with the increase of the Reynolds number. Okay. So, there is no interaction with the one layer to the another layer, that is all one can think of, and this has been experimentally checked and found that for constant heat flux boundary condition, no matter what Reynolds number you do, as long as the flow is laminar, that is the Reynolds number is still around 2000 to 2300, you continue to get the Nusselt number as 4.3636. In fact, doing experiments for laminar flow is much difficult than turbulent flow, because heat loss computations are difficult. If you do the same thing for constant wall temperature, it's quite difficult to do. It's an iterative solution. We don't really do for undergraduates. For postgraduate, this we give as an assignment. So please don't give this as an assignment for UG guys. If it is for postgraduate students, definitely go ahead and give this as an assignment. You get 3.66. Only one question which comes to our mind is, for constant heat flux boundary condition, I am getting a Nusselt number of 4.366, but for constant wall temperature, for constant heat flux, I am getting Nusselt number of 4.36. For constant wall temperature, I am getting a Nusselt number of 3.66. Why is the Nusselt number for constant wall temperature lower than that of constant heat flux? That can be explained through temperature distribution. If for the constant heat flux case, how does the temperature vary with location? So this is the temperature of the wall and this is the bulk fluid temperature. And here in case of constant wall temperature, this is for constant heat flux. For constant wall temperature, this is wall temperature and my fluid temperature. What is happening? The delta T in constant heat flux case is constant throughout. But for constant wall temperature case, the delta T, Gajendra, you are sleeping. Constant wall temperature, what is happening? The temperature difference is decreasing. For constant wall temperature, as I move along, the temperature difference between the wall and the fluid is decreasing. Heat transfer is essentially because of the temperature difference. If the temperature difference is decreasing, the heat transfer is not so effective. So that is why the heat transfer coefficient in case of constant heat flux case is higher than that of constant wall temperature case. So everything has a reason if we can try to understand. Okay. So now that is about constant wall temperature. Like that, one can, as I said in the morning in Shah and London, for various configurations, you can get both friction factor and Nusselt numbers. Of course, this is for laminar flow, both for constant wall temperature and constant heat flux. No matter whatever is the configuration, you will see that for constant heat flux case, the Nusselt numbers are higher than that for constant wall temperature case. So now there are various correlations for a developing flow. You will see that there is L by D sitting, and for property, another important thing here is that in few correlations, you would see property variation. That is how there is a property variation from inlet to outlet. My bulk temperature is changing from inlet to outlet. So my properties are also going to vary from inlet to outlet. So how do I account? Usually the property variation is accounted by this factor, that is mu b by mu wall or mu surface to the power of 0.14. Mu b is taken as the viscosity at Ti plus Te by 2, that is inlet temperature and outlet temperature average of the two. So it is not an unreasonable assumption, because at least if it is constant heat flux, the wall temperature is varying linearly. Now, before I come to this problem, I just want to deal with turbulent flow in tubes. In turbulent flow in pipes, what is happening? There is a standard correlation, what is called as Dittus-Boelter correlation. So this is a new equal to, let me write it, because we need to, I think as engineers, we need to remember this. I do not think we can afford to forget this. That is Nusselt number is equal to 0.023 Re to the power of 0.8 and Pr to the power of n, where n equal to 0.4 for heating and 0.3 for cooling. See, one important thing, what we need to say is, that is cooling of the fluid, not the tube, cooling of the fluid through the tube. So that is heating and cooling. It is with reference to the fluid, not with reference to the tube. And the properties are taken at Ti plus Te by 2, that is properties of rho, mu, Cp, K in Re and Pr are taken as the average temperature of inlet and outlet temperature. How has this equation come from? This equation has come thoroughly through experiments. And this is what is called as Dittus Volter. If I remember correctly, this correlation was published in 1950, and even today it works. And he took around hundreds of experimental data, and he collected all that data which was existing till that time and put an empirical correlation. And of course, he knew that nu equal to C R e to the power of m and P R to the power of n, and he also knew that n is roughly around 0.3. So, that is what he did for heating and cooling, he is suggesting differently. This is 0.4, 0.3 essentially takes care of property variations, which we do not do in this, that is mu b by mu wall to the power of n. That is what he is doing here. So, and R e to the power of 0.8 is an empirical correlation. So, whenever you do turbulent flow, you always check whether you are getting R e to the power of 0.8. Another important thing is that I had not answered for in external flows, that is in turbulent flows, the heat transfer coefficient is independent of, heat transfer coefficient is independent of boundary condition. It does not matter whether I do with constant wall temperature and constant heat flux, constant wall temperature or constant heat flux. So, in both the cases, I am going to get the same Nusselt number. Why? Because it is of turbulence. It is so random, it is so much mixing that it does not know what is the boundary condition. So, whatever they have measured for constant wall temperature and constant heat flux, the heat transfer coefficient for the in both the cases are within the experimental uncertainty, they are matching. So, that is why it is stated that the heat transfer coefficient is independent of boundary condition as long as my flow is turbulent. Okay. So, I think with this we have stated the correlations both in tubes and pipes, sorry, both for laminar and turbulent. So, there are various correlations, I am not going to touch each one by one. Another important correlations which is usually used is Nilinsky's correlation. Dittus-Bolter works very well for gases and Nilinsky works very well for liquids. I have learned this very hard way. Okay, whenever we were measuring for water, we never got the matching well for water with Dittus-Bolter, but somehow I landed up with this Nilinsky's correlation which was there in our lab in a old thesis. I landed up in this correlation and then I got my correlation, my experimental data right. What is that is Nilinsky around 1970s or 1975, over and above the data what Dittus-Bolter collected, he collected again for next 25 years data and fit the correlation and gave the correlation in terms of friction factor. In fact, this correlation can be derived from fundamentals. This form can be derived from fundamentals. What is not derived is only this 12.7. 12.7 is just tweaked based on the experimental data. Actually, this comes from universal velocity profile and the universal temperature profile. It is beyond the scope of our course. We will not be able to teach all that, but if we take a convective heat and mass transfer course, we need to derive how this comes from. So, this is semi empirical, we can say it is not purely empirical, although Dittus is purely empirical, but Nilinsky is semi empirical. And for liquid metals, again for you have different correlations for liquid metals, and again you can see it is R e to the power of 0.85. Although we are making a small nitpicking here, you see that there is a slight variation, not very much variation. You can say constant wall temperature and constant heat flux is same. Yeah. So, this Dittus-Bolter correlation, actually always there is a problem when you are measuring the heat transfer coefficient between 2300 and 10,000. It is a very difficult zone. So, we always, whenever you are designing a heat exchanger, you ensure that your Reynolds number is greater than 10,000. Although we say that the flow transits from laminar to turbulent around 2300, for an engineer it is not 2300, for an engineer it is 10,000. You ensure that your flow is greater than 10,000, so that you are safely you have ensured that the flow is indeed turbulent. Okay. So, that is how for a fluid mechanician, he will say, no, my Reynolds number greater than 2300 is just transiting to turbulent. But for a heat transfer expert who is doing heat exchanger design, he will ensure that Reynolds number is greater than 10,000 for doubly being sure that the flow is indeed turbulent. even these correlations are valid for Reynolds number greater than 10,000, for simple reason that for Reynolds number less than 10,000, uncertainties in measurements of H is quite high. So, that is the reason why we do not suggest this correlation for Reynolds number less than 10,000. And of course, for rough surface 1 upon square root of f, you can see that this is epsilon by d sitting, this is Kolbrook's correlation, this is not, this is semi empirical. I will just take 5 minutes to tell how that correlation has come. I am not going to derive that, because for that is simple fluid mechanics, but nevertheless I will just do it on a fast track how one can get simple friction factor. See, all of us use for friction factor in pipe. What is the friction factor correlation we use? Generally, we use what is called as Blasius friction factor. Again Blasius, okay? Blasius is there everywhere. Blasius is like God to us. F is equal to 0.3164 Re to the power of minus 0.25, okay? This is Blasius friction factor. Now, this is coming purely from empirical relation, simple curve fit. Now, what did Prandtl do is that we have velocity distribution. So, if I take the flow rate pi r squared u average and I know the velocity, if I take velocity profile, and what is my velocity profile? I have the universal velocity profile u plus equal to y plus. If I take that, that is u plus equal to a log y plus plus b, with a equal to 2.5 and b equal to 5.5, and do the transformation of all this in terms of u plus and y plus. I am not doing the algebra, I am sorry about that, I cannot do that. If you do this algebra, but the full algebra is here, all that I am doing is transform this u and y and r in terms of u plus, y plus and r plus. The definition of u plus is u by u tau, and y plus is y u tau by nu. And why I am doing this? Because I know u plus in terms of y plus. If I do that and substitute and integrate that, and if I do that integration, I am going to get the correlation as 1 upon square root of f equal to 2.035 log of r e square root of f minus 0.9129. So, this was derived by Prandtl. What did Prandtl do? He did not blindly apply f equal to 0.3164 r e to the power of minus 1 by 4. He went back and saw that with this data, with this correlation, whatever he, with this relation what he has derived from fundamentals, universal velocity profile, he took the Nikuradze's experimental data, which is available. If you see here, he took the Nikuradze's data and he sees that the Blasius correlation does not work for higher Reynolds numbers. So, he tweaked this 2.035 and 0.9129 just to 2 and 0.8, and he finds that for full Nikuradze's whole data, this equation fits very well. Okay? It is not about empiricism. Why I am emphasizing this? Because why is it so universal? That universal profile is universal because of this reason. You could derive the friction factor from fundamentals. Okay? So, that is the beauty of this. And now Prandtl was convinced that that universal velocity profile is applicable and can be used for deriving an engineering parameter. Actually, for Nusselt number also one can derive this. I am not doing that. I am just saying that for, if I use universal velocity profile, I can derive friction factor as a function of Reynolds number. Again, it is proved for friction factor, all that I need to know is Reynolds number. Friction factor is a function of Reynolds number. Everything is getting converging. Whatever we are studying is the whole lot of effort of 100 years. So, that is why everything seems to be falling in place, that is 1 plus 1 equal to 2. So, this is what is being told here, and for rough surface also we can do the same thing. I am not doing, please go back and do this. You can get, if you do the again for universal velocity profile for rough surface, because for rough surface I am only in turbulent boundary layer. I have to take again a plus log of y plus. But instead of y plus, I take r upon epsilon. If you do that, you will get 1 upon square root of f equal to 2 log epsilon by d 3.7 r e square root of f. So, this is what is called as Kolbrook's correlation. So, I think we have solved all of the friction factors. This is the velocity profile for turbulent flow. You go through this, and this says that this is parabolic, and for turbulent flow this is hat profile, and you take care of all other things. That is this N, that is power law for circular, for turbulent profile, U by U average is equal to Y by R to the power of 1 by N, and that N is a function of Reynolds number. That is what is being shown here. Okay. So, with this I think we will take questions, and so I do not think we will solve any of these problems, because they are simple plug-in problems. They are elaborately put. All that we say is first find out RE, pick up the right correlation friction factor, and pick up the right correlation for Nusselt number, and get the heat transfer coefficient, and get the heat transfer rate. I think we will take more questions rather than solving these mundane problems, that is plug-in problems. PSG Coimbatore.
Sir, in one of the graphs which shows the variation of H with theta for flow over cylinder, the Nusselt number is high at the stagnation point where the flow is almost at rest. So I don't know how to interpret. Can you please explain?
The question is for external flow over a cylinder, the Nusselt number is taken is high at the initial stagnation point and then drops. So how do you explain that? Is that the correct way of interpreting your question? Yeah. Okay. So this, what is Nusselt, what is stagnation point? Stagnation point refers to the point of zero velocity. The flow has stagnated. Okay. There is, at that point, the entire entire kinetic energy has come to zero. After that, what is happening? The flow, the boundary layer is being formed over the cylinder. Because of this boundary layer formation, we are trying to, if you are trying to talk from a heat transfer point of view, the boundary layer is like a region which is offering a resistance to heat transfer. So that point, stagnation point, where the fluid has been brought to rest, that point is the region of highest heat transfer. Then what happens? The boundary layer develops, the resistance to heat transfer increases slowly, and then after this so called transition to turbulence, etc., there is a further increase. Okay. So the primary the decrease in the heat transfer from the initial stagnation point onwards is due to the development of the boundary layer at that point. Okay.
Thank you, sir. One more question. This is related to the variation of H in the entry region. The H decreases in the entry region, and I would like to know what is the reason for the decrease in H?
Okay. See, what is happening, again answer incidentally happens to be the same. The question is, in the developing region, heat transfer coefficient is decreasing with the increase of developing length. So why is it so? Again, the boundary layer thickness is, when we started off, there is no boundary layer thickness. That is why my heat transfer coefficient is maximum. Now, as I am moving towards the center of the pipe, my boundary layer thickness is increasing, because of which my heat transfer coefficient continuously decreases, and then it becomes constant. Why? Because my boundary layer thickness is also constant. So that is another way of looking at it and explaining that why heat transfer coefficient continuously decreases and then becomes constant. Baramati, any questions please?
First, about thermal and hydraulic boundary layer in a case of stationary plate. But if we could talk about the moving plate, for example, a submarine moving in a sea, then there is a temperature and velocity gradient, then how is the formation of thermal and hydraulic boundary layer there?
Okay, very good question. Actually, I have not touched this. Yeah, the question is, the question asked by one of the participants is that, what happens to my boundary layer when I am moving, that is when my plate is moving. The participant has taken the example that my submarine is moving, but my fluid is still. See, the answer is as follows. When Wright brothers did his experiment, he did not actually in a wind tunnel, whenever we do experiments, I put my aerofoil fixed and my flow is flowing over it. It is same as my aircraft moving in a still air. What is important is the relative velocity, but not which one is moving and which one is stationary. The boundary layer growth does not depend on the which one is moving, that is whether the solid is moving or the fluid is moving. Here in the submarine case, for example, my submarine is moving and but my fluid is still. And in the aeroplane also, plane is moving but the fluid is still. If I have to simulate these two cases in my lab, I will put my submarine still and make the water flow over the submarine. But the boundary layer growth in my lab, whatever I get, and the boundary layer growth what I get in the submarine, they are all same. So, sum and substance is that what is important is the relative velocity. If the relative velocity is same, the boundary layer growth is going to be same, then the heat transfer coefficients are going to be same, and then the friction factors are also going to be same. Same thing for thermal boundary layer thickness also. Over to you.
What is the effect of cryogenic liquid on the velocity profile and temperature profile?
Okay. The question is, what is the effect of cryogenic liquid on the liquid temperature profile and the velocity profile? Cryogenic liquid is also not out of the world liquid. It is liquid nitrogen only. If it is in liquid phase, it acts like a liquid. If it is in gaseous phase, it acts like a gas. So, it is as good as any other fluid as long as we know its Prandtl number. That is all.
Sir, one more question.
Good afternoon, sir. While morning, we discussing the constant wall heat flux condition. Temperature profiles were drawn at two locations, x1 and x2. So, whether what happens to the surface pressure, whether it increases or remains constant, how it increases surface temperature, constant wall heat flux condition?
See, constant wall heat, the question is, for constant wall heat flux condition, we had drawn two temperature profiles at two different axial locations. Okay. The question the participant is asking is, what happens to the surface temperature? Does it increase? The answer is, we are supplying heat. Constant wall heat flux is being maintained. That means watt per meter square is fixed. Therefore, the fluid temperature will also have to increase. This is logically clear. Now, what we are saying is, because heat flux is constant, the wall temperature will also increase. In fact, if you look at this projection, I have shown a small arrow for TS1, a shorter length, whereas TS2 on the next diagram is quite big. Okay, fully developed flow, heat flux is constant, but what we are saying is the wall temperature will increase. Why should it increase? Because I have inherently added more heat to the fluid. We are able to understand bulk fluid temperature increasing with the same logic, wall surface temperature will also increase. Okay?
Okay.
Sir, one more question, please.
Yeah.
This is regarding Nusselt number in laminar flow. With increase in aspect ratio, that is A by B ratio, Nusselt number is increasing. Can you explain this?
Okay. So let
in the chart, you have shown that higher is A by B, higher is Nusselt number.
The question is, in internal flows for higher aspect ratio channel, there is an increase in the Nusselt number compared to that of the low aspect ratio channel. So, what you are saying is, actually as A by B is increasing, that is A is becoming wider than B. That means B is becoming smaller and smaller compared to that of A. Okay. The question is, here in this figure, as A by B is increasing, that is, as my A by B is increasing, my Nusselt number, whether it is constant wall temperature or constant heat flux, the Nusselt numbers are increasing. Why? Because the interference between the one wall to the another wall, that is the boundary layer interaction, is increasing in case of higher aspect ratio. In case of higher aspect ratio. Let us draw this and see. Yeah. So, if I have lower aspect ratio as opposed to higher, this is the first one is the higher aspect ratio, and sorry, first one is the low aspect ratio and the second one is the high aspect ratio. In this, the interaction in the second one, the interaction of the boundary layers is more rigorous, because of which the Nusselt numbers in case of high aspect ratio, the Nusselt numbers are higher. That is how one can think of it. Or one wall, if you have to talk it in a very layman, one wall is talking with the another wall more rigorously compared to the first case, that is the square case. R.C. Patel, Shirpur.
Sir, my question is that in case of main film temperature and bulk temperature, if there are inlet and outlet temperature is given for the water or any fluid, and the surface temperature of the plate or tube is given, at that time we are going to consider mean film temperature. So what is the reason that we are going to take mean film temperature, as the temperature at inlet and outlet both are given? Means where we use bulk mean temperature and where we use mean film temperature.
Okay, the question asked is, where do we use bulk mean temperature and where do we use mean fluid temperature? Mean fluid temperature. When he says mean fluid temperature, he means that it is the average of inlet and outlet temperature of the fluid. See, if we see carefully in our correlations, usually the mean film temperature, that is T infinity plus T s by 2 concept, is used in external flows. But for most of the correlations, if not all, for most of the correlations in internal flows, we use inlet to outlet temperature average, that is the bulk mean temperature. Okay? That is inlet. So, to summarize, for we take T i plus T e by 2 for internal flows, and we take T s plus T infinity by 2 for external flows for most of the correlations. Is that okay?
Is there in internal fluid also we are going to consider mean film temperature sometimes in some numericals I have seen.
See, in some numericals sometimes we take mean film temperature, not the mean fluid temperature. That is specific to that correlation, but that is specific to the correlation in which he might have, the experimentalist might have generated the correlation using the mean film temperature rather than taking the mean fluid temperature. So, whoever is generating the correlation is going to specify for me whether it is going to be average bulk temperature or average film temperature. Okay?
Another thing would be, in an application where exit bulk fluid temperature is not known, we can say that in the limiting condition, the bulk fluid temperature at exit would be equal to the surface temperature. So, that also you can say that T s plus T inlet by 2, where this T s is approximated to T mean at exit in the limiting condition. So, that way also you can look at it.
Yes.
Sir, one of the participant having a doubt regarding the convection or conduction in case of grease, a lubricating fluid which we are using in vehicles, that is grease. In case of that fluid, which type of or which mode of heat transfer we have to consider?
Okay, grease is a sticky fluid. The question asked is, if grease is there in our vehicles which we are using, how should I handle this grease? What will be the mode of the heat transfer? Grease is actually a wax, grease is wax, that means it is acting like a sort of solid until it reaches the melting point temperature. Once it starts melting, then it starts acting like a liquid. So, in fact, fluid dynamically we can think of this as a thixotropic fluid. That means some initial stress is required to melt it. Once it has gotten melted, it becomes like a liquid. So, it is not going to be Newtonian, but once wax becomes like a liquid, then we can perhaps assume it as a Newtonian fluid, and whatever fundamentals we have studied so far can be applied to the wax which has melted into a liquid. But till wax melting to liquid, it is a melting problem. That is, whatever heat is generated, it has to be consumed for melting, that is latent heat of fusion or latent heat of melting, we have to utilize that for that, and subsequent to that it will become convective heat transfer, wherein which generally, of course, it depends whether where you are using forced convection or natural convection. The question asked was by Anna University was that when a spacecraft moves into atmosphere or when it leaves the space, how does the boundary layer grow? Before moving the space, actually if I see in the question, what it is told is that the please comment the development of hydrodynamic boundary layer and thermal boundary layer when the spacecraft enters the atmosphere from space. Okay. So, it has gotten entered into the atmosphere. So, what is happening is when it is entering, we need to appreciate that it is entering at a supersonic, not supersonic, hypersonic flow. That is, Mach number is going to be very high, that is as high as 5 times. That means, velocity, Mach number is velocity of sound, velocity of a fluid or the velocity of my rocket in my case to the velocity of sound in air equal to 5. So, V upon 330 if I take as the gamma RT, taking ambient temperature conditions, of course, in space the temperature is going to be different. So, I am taking 330 into 5, what is that I am going to get? It is going to be around 1500 plus 150, that is 1650 meters per second. So, it is not a small speed, it is not a small speed. When this kind of velocity is there, when this kind of velocity is there, there is for high speed flows, the Q double dash equal to H into T wall minus T infinity will not work. The boundary layer will be growing the same way it is going to grow for, let us say, if this is my spacecraft, when it is going to come, the boundary layer is going to grow the same way. But the only difference is that this boundary layer is compressible boundary layer, it is not incompressible boundary layer. Compressible boundary layer. What all we have studied so far, it is all incompressible boundary layer. What is it which is going to make it different for compressible boundary layer is that Q double dash is no longer T wall minus T infinity. We define Q double dash as H into T wall minus T adiabatic wall temperature, wherein which adiabatic wall temperature is also not known. That is, we cannot take T infinity as the reference. The fluid which is near the wall is also going to get heated up, and I cannot take T infinity as my reference, I have to take some other reference temperature. That reference temperature is what is called as T adiabatic wall temperature. So, point is the boundary layer, both thermal and the hydrodynamic boundary layer will grow the same way as it grew for flat plate and all, but the only difference is that this boundary layer is compressible boundary layer. And the heat transfer coefficient definition, that is the Newton's law of cooling, is not going to be Q double dash equal to H into T wall minus T infinity, but it is going to be Q double dash equal to H into T wall minus T adiabatic wall. So, but then both there are two unknowns, that is H is an unknown and also adiabatic wall temperature is an unknown, both have to be measured experimentally. How to measure them? I think let's not take up that right now. Okay, so we will move on to next question, NIT Tiruchirappalli or NIT Trichy.
Sir, while dealing with convection phenomenon, We always come across flow over flat plate, flow over cylinder, flow over sphere. But in real life situation, we'll come across so much complex shapes and bodies. So how, for these kind of complex shapes, how to derive a heat transfer equation as well as Nusselt number equation, and how to model this kind of system, sir? Over to you, sir.
Okay. See, the question asked is, the real life objects are not going to be flat plates or spheres or cylinders. How do I handle flow over real life objects? For example, human body. If I take flow over a human body itself is an object. I can have a boundary layer on my body. That is what happens in essentially in cold time. I keep myself, my hands, what is that? I keep decreasing my surface area by folding my hands whenever I am feeling cold. Essentially, what I am trying to do is, I am trying to decrease the heat transfer rate by decreasing the surface area. So, heat transfer coefficient is same, cooling heat transfer coefficient same, Ts minus T body is also, T body minus T infinity is also same, but what I am trying to do is As I am decreasing. Coming back to your question, how do we handle for non-symmetric objects or real life objects? For example, a human body, I will idealize it as a flow around a cylinder. Of course, if I have to really make nitpicking and I have to start modeling shoulders and all, again same equations are not going to be different. Same conservation of mass, conservation of momentum and conservation of energy is valid. Only thing is that I will have to take the recourse of CFD, closed form solutions are not possible. Either I have to do the experiments scaled down, or I have to take the recourse of computational fluid dynamics to solve this. In computational fluid dynamics also, you divide the complete control volume into small control volumes and apply the energy balance, momentum balance and the mass balance for each of these control volumes.
Sir, when constant heat flux, the Nusselt number is 4.36. When it is a constant wall temperature, the Nusselt number is 3.66. Why it is lesser in constant wall temperature?
Okay, I had answered this. The question asked is, for constant heat flux boundary condition, we have a Nusselt number of, for a constant heat flux boundary condition, we have a Nusselt number of, for constant heat flux boundary condition, we have a Nusselt number of 4.36. For constant wall temperature case, we have a Nusselt number of 3.66. Why is that for constant wall temperature lower than that of constant heat flux? In fact, I had answered this question in my lecture itself, perhaps this point has got missed, no problem. T versus x if I put, so for constant heat flux, what do we get? This is Ts and this is Tm, okay? This is bulk temperature, this is bulk temperature and this is surface temperature. So, note that the difference between the surface temperature and the bulk temperature is constant, is not varying with space. On the other hand, for a constant wall temperature boundary condition case, that is T wall equal to constant, what is happening? And this is the bulk temperature. What is happening? This is actually exponential function. Professor Arun derived this, that is logarithmic temperature. So, that is, this temperature difference is a decreasing with the increase of x. So, delta T is decreasing. As the temperature gradient is decreasing, the heat transfer, amount of the heat transfer also should decrease. So, basically the net delta T Lm of constant wall temperature will be lower than the delta T Lm for constant heat flux. For delta T Lm in constant heat flux is Ts minus Tm. So, there is no variation. So, that is the reason why for constant heat flux boundary condition we get higher Nusselt number compared to that of constant wall temperature case. Okay, over to you. Amal Jyoti Kerala, any questions?
Sir, actually we have two questions. One is that the surface roughness, how do we measure the surface roughness? Is it the height of the maximum ridge or valley, something like that? And second question is that, sir, the entry length, suppose we calculate for the laminar flow, I put the Reynolds number as 2000 and the diameter of the pipe as almost 1 inch. No, I got the answer as at least 3 meters. No? That means that suppose you are going to fix a valve or something in between that, Now, will it affect the flow conditions or in laboratory, do you want to actually consider the entry length and fix the apparatus according to that?
Yes. Okay. So, now the first question was how do we measure, there are two questions asked by one of the professors, that is how do we measure, the first question is surface roughness, how does one measure this, and the second question is if I put a valve, my developing length is going to get affected, how do I handle this? Let me answer first question. For surface roughness, what people usually do is they measure what is called as, they measure the surface roughness using either tally surf meter, that is there is a perthometer, this is also called as perthometer. If you discuss this with manufacturing guys, they will be knowing better than me, but nevertheless there is a stylus. If I have a rough surface, this is my rough surface, let us say there is a stylus which moves on this surface. When it moves on this surface, it captures the movement, and based on this movement again I will take, like the way we handled turbulence, I will take average surface roughness, maximum surface roughness, minimum surface roughness, and of course we are taking not the maximum, but we take the average surface roughness. That is the answer for the first question. Second question is that if we take L by D equal to, what was that, 0.06 Re for laminar flow, and if I take Reynolds number equal to 1000 meter and diameter equal to 25 mm, what do I get? L equal to 0.06 into 25 into 10 to the power of minus 3 into 1000. That means 10 to the power of minus 3 and 1000 gets cancelled out, 25 into 0.06, 25 6 are 150, 25 6 is 150, and I get how much length? No, 1.5 meters. I get 1.5 meters. Yes, I need to put 1.5 meters as the developing length. Let us say this is my developing length. Now, let us say you are putting an orifice plate or something. See, for an orifice plate, what is the necessary condition? We need to generate fully developed flow. Okay. For getting fully developed flow, what do you ensure? You need to ensure that there is 1.5 meters given. Now, for example, in between there is a valve, then it is going to disturb the flow. Again after the valve, I need to put again 1.5 meters. So, flow, of course, there are some flow conditioners and all, let us not get into that. The point is that if you have a valve or any disturbance, bend 90 degree, 180 degree, that is if you have a 90 degree bend like this, or 180 degree bend like this, or 180 degree perpendicular, again it takes a bend out of plane, that is 90 degree two, 90 degree bends, one out of plane. So, then in all of these cases, you have to downstream this disturbance, you have to have again developing length of 1.5 meter given, otherwise the flow is not fully developed. Okay.
Sir, in case of roughness value, do we actually measure the height of the protuberance which is from the surface, or do we take it as the average of the maximum height or the minimum height? Do we take it as average, or we take it as the maximum height?
Okay, the question asked is for after measuring the surface roughness, do I take the average roughness or things like that? See, if I were to plot, I will take the tally surf meter or perthometer, and I will plot height versus protuberance height from the base versus location all over the place. That is, this is my flat plate on which protuberances are there and on which I have moved my tally surf meter. So, if I put my height is also going to be something like this. So, how do I represent this? I represent this by again h bar, that is h average, and then again h prime. So, one is the RMS value, another one is the average value. So, to answer your question, both average height and the RMS value are to be represented. Is that okay?
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Over and over.
VJTI Mumbai, any questions?
Sir, I would like to know about the laminar sublayer in case of internal flow.
Okay, the question asked is, what is laminar sublayer in case of internal flow? laminar sublayer in case of internal flow and the laminar sublayer in case of external flow, these two are not different. That's what I said, and that is why it is called as universal profile. So in case of this is the universal profile, this is the viscous sublayer. We said that the viscous sublayer is same whether it is internal flow or external flow, viscous sublayer is same. So you are going to get y plus equal to, that is u plus equal to, for all u plus equal to y plus, that is for all y plus less than 5, u plus is equal to y plus. That is, what is y plus? Y plus is y u tau by nu. What is u tau? U tau is square root of tau all by rho. So if we are not understanding, let me answer this little differently, because I think none of us are understanding what exactly is this. Let me take, I think I will generate this problem, or I will generate this problem and put up this in Moodle. That is, if I take the friction factor from, because I do not have calculator, that is why I will not be able to do this. So I will take the friction factor from the Moody's chart and then calculate the tau wall, and from tau wall we will calculate back the y. So that is how one can check whether I have broken the sublayer or not. The point is, laminar sublayer, whether it is internal flow or external flow, it is just the same. Thank you.